At the end of September, my crab apple tree got whacked by a windstorm. Like lots of people around Albuquerque who had the same thing happen in their yards, I started wondering what I should do with my yard. So I called in an arborist who came to look at the tree and talk about kind of the future of it. He said that even if I decide to save this crab apple tree, I should be thinking about a replacement tree. He asked me what kind of tree I like, and of course, because I live in Albuquerque, I said a cottonwood. He said cottonwoods aren't a great bet for Albuquerque as the region gets warmer and drier, and I should think about something like a desert willow or a redbud. Also checked in with my friend Marisa Thompson, who works for the New Mexico State University's Extension Services. She also cautioned against cottonwoods, which she said she realizes that's an unpopular thing for people to hear because we do all love our cottonwood trees, but they need a lot of water, they get really big, and they tend to break branches off. So in thinking about the future, I asked around what I should be doing and found out that the Nature Conservancy actually has on its website a guide for climate-ready tree planting, made especially for people who are living here in New Mexico and Albuquerque who want to think about replacement trees for the future. And this guide can help you whether you're looking for big trees, small trees, whatever kind of space you have. 2 years ago for our land, we visited with arborist Joran Viers, who talked to us about the importance of urban trees and urban forests and how to plan for those to be healthy as the region gets warmer and drier. So here's that show.
Wildland foresters are concerned with board feet and lumber. What we are concerned with is how do we keep our trees healthy? How do we grow good trees? How do we grow them in a way that keeps them safe for people who live and work and move around those trees? So this is a planting that I think is a really nice example. I really like this. These trees have been given a...
Joran Viers is a forester who works not in the forests, but right here in Albuquerque. He pays attention to the city's urban forest, the trees in our parks and medians, neighborhoods and yards.
My role is largely in the parks, but also more broadly to oversee tree care in the city in terms of planning and planting and maintenance and removals and just trying to have kind of an overall vision of what we're trying to do with our urban forest. How do we support it and how do we allow it to give us the benefits that an urban forest does provide?
And those benefits are many, from providing habitats for wildlife to the electricity savings from the valuable shade that trees provide.
We have a tremendous heat island effect issue in this city because of all of the concrete, the asphalt, the gravel out there, and that kind of green shade really helps to bring that down. We also have stormwater retention benefits, and that's an area that we're increasingly looking at. How do we design our stormwater systems so that we can bring that water into the landscape first and settle it there before it hits the whole stormwater system, and that actually makes that system last a lot longer. Here you can see a really good example of the value of soil volume for trees and how well they can grow. We've got these trees that are planted in this fairly wide cutout with plant material all throughout and irrigation all throughout. These sycamores were planted less than 4 years ago, and they have just shot up out of the ground. And in large part, that's due to the fact that they have uncompacted, irrigated soil, sufficient volume of that to really allow for good growth. So we can look and see they are holding lots of leaves, nice thick canopy, not a lot of blue sky that you can see through it, not a lot of dead branch tips in the canopy, and that tells us that these are trees growing really well. What we see on the other side of the street is the same species planted at the same time, going in at the same size, and the average size of those trees is much smaller than the average size of these trees. They're doing okay, but what's limiting them is they're in a very narrow cutout and there isn't a whole lot of extra irrigation going in there to support additional plant material. So they're already beginning to feel the effect of that limited soil volume.
So the right kind of soil and irrigation are key, but Veer says that costs money, which leads to another planning decision, one of quality over quantity.
You know, maybe in new developments we require less trees, but we require more resources per tree, so that we then actually get the results that we want without overly burdening the developer with the costs of installation. I would rather have, you know, two or three really nice trees than 10 that have to be pulled out every 5 years because they're dead again.
And what kinds of trees you decide to plant is another important piece of the puzzle. The city has come up with some unique approaches to identifying species that work in our unique climate, especially as the impacts of climate change continue to hit home.
We have a little nursery that the city runs, and my vision for that nursery is to use it as kind of a testing ground. Let's bring in stuff that isn't currently available in the market locally, but appears like it would do well. Grow it up in the nursery to a size where we can put it out into parks and other landscapes and then see how it does.
Because in the end, Viers says, the vitality of a city can be measured in part by the health of its trees and plant life.
There's good research from the social sciences about how much the exposure to nature provides emotional and social benefits. In a residential environment, you find lower levels of stress, you find more community engagement, and so there's just a whole host of different kinds of benefits that the urban forest can help us with.
For New Mexico in Focus and Our Land, I'm Laura Paskus.